it is very common for every one of you that you are having a bank account. Also, you issue the check for paying your various dues like electricity bill, mobile bills, etc. Your banker, financier also take from you post-dated check, that is PDC, when you take loan, that is car loan, home loan or personal loan. Many times it happens that your check is dishonored or bounced due to the various reasons like insufficiency of funds in your bank account. Channel aapne subscribe kare diya hoga. Agar aapne abhi tak is channel ko subscribe nahi kiya hai, to abhi subscribe karke bell icon button ko daba dijiye, jisse aage aane wale sabhi videos ke update aapko timely milte rahe aur ye aapke liye bilkul free hai. The most common reason for dishonor of the check are lack of funds in your account from where check is issued, and that is the main and most common reason for the check to bounce. If the check is overridden, next one is the problem with the date of the check, that is either post-dated check or the check having the date which is more than 3 months old on the date of the presentation of a check, or if the date is not mentioned or written incorrectly. If the signature is absent, that is no signature on the check, or the signature in the check does not match with the specimen signature kept by the bank, that is signature mismatch. If the name of the payee is absent, that is not written on the check or not clearly written. If the amount written in the words and figures does not match with each other and differ. If the account number is not mentioned clearly or is altogether absent. If the person who issued the check orders the bank to stop payment on the check. If the code of law has given an instruction or order to the bank to stop payment on the check. Further, if the person who issued the check has closed the account before presentation of the check by the check recipient. Also, if the fund in the bank account are insufficient to meet the payment of the check. If the bank receives the information regarding the debt or lunacy or insolvency of the person who issued the check. If any alteration made on the check is not proved by the person who issued the check by giving his or her signature, or it is a disfigured or damaged check, any of these issues in the check may result into dishonor thereof by the bank. In today's video, if you are an accused in the check bounce case, means that you have issued a check to somebody and the check has bounced, and the party to whom you have issued the check has filed a case in the court against you under Section 138 of the Negotiable Instrument Act, and various defenses which you take before the court, whether they may be accepted by the court or not. Also, I shall be discussing with you the various remedies available to you when a check is issued by you has bounced. If those are applied to the facts of your case, then you may win that case, or that case may be rejected by the court of law. Keep watching this video till end in order to get the full benefit out of this video. My dear friends, firstly, I shall share with you the problems in dishonor of the check. When the check is dishonored, a check return memo is sent by the bank to whom check was issued, that is payee, stating reasons of the dishonor of the check. The payee can resubmit the check if he believes that it will be honored second time. The payee can prosecute or file a case in court against the person who issued the check, that is drawn legally, if the check is bounced again. The Negotiable Instrument Act is applicable for the cases related to the dishonor of the check. As per Section 138 of this Act, dishonor of check is a criminal offense and is punishable with monetary penalty or imprisonment up to 2 years or both. So far as penalty is concerned, if a check is bounced, then a penalty is levied on both the issuer of the check, that is drawer, and the receiver of the check, that is payee, by their respective bankers. The person will additionally have to pay late payment charges if dishonored check is against repayment of loan. So far as the damage to the credit history of yours is concerned, your credit history is negatively impacted if a check is dishonored, since your payment activities are reported to the credit bureaus by the financial institutions from whom you have taken the loan, either home loan or car loan or personal loan. The lender will trust you if you have a good credit score. In order to have a good credit score, it is a good practice that your check do not get bounced or dishonored. Your good payment activities will help you build your good CIBIL score and benefit you at the time when you approach your banker for a fresh loan. Keep the above points in mind while writing the check so that the check is not dishonored. Unfortunately, if a check issued by you got bounced, in that case, what remedies are available to you to defend your case in the court are shared here. I am going to share with you the most important things which you should try to find out in the facts of your check dishonor case so that you can win that case or the case against you for the dishonor of the check is dismissed by the court and you may save yourself from the various penal provisions of the Negotiable Instrument Act. Normally it is seen that various parties against whom the case is filed in court for dishonor of the check, then they are taking very illogical and unrealistic defense before the court in their check bouncing case, which are not tenable in the court, and the court does not recognize them and do not grant any relief to the accused of the check dishonor. Some person take the defense before the court that they have only signed the check and other contents of the check are not filled up or written by them. This is a very weak defense under the Negotiable Instrument Act. This will not save you in the court. Some persons take defense before the court when their check is bounced, that their checkbook was stolen, or that their check was stolen. Then after they make a complaint at the police station, or they file online complaint after the dishonor of the check. This is not going to help you out in the court because this is also very big defense in check bouncing case. This justification is treated as an afterthought by the court and therefore court does not give any benefit or relief for this. Some persons take the defense before the court that mere se kisi ne dara dhamka ke check le liya tha. That is, the check was taken by intimidating to the check issuer by the other party. In this case, the question will be asked, jab aapko dara dhamka ke check liya gaya tha kisi aur ne, to why did not you file a complaint before the police at that time immediately? That today, when check bounced, then you are complaining ki mere se dara dhamka ke check le liya tha. This defense will also not help you out in the check dishonor case in the court. Some accused of the check dishonor do not accept the legal notice when that come to their house or they change their house or residence so that they may not receive the legal notice. This is also not a defense under the Negotiable Instrument Act because as per the Indian Evidence Act, if the legal notice is sent to your last known address and you do not receive the legal notice, then that will be deemed to have been served upon you and received by you under the Indian Evidence Act. Court will presume that the legal notice has been served upon you and you are avoiding willfully to take that notice. Some other accused make certain other mistakes also. Like even if they accept the legal notice, even then they do not appear before the court on the appointed date fixed for hearing. They change their address, they change their residence or they abscond also. Gayab ho jate hain. All these tactics will just weaken your case and will not help you out in check dishonor case. If you try to run away from the legal process, then the magistrate will issue the warrant against you and you will be arrested and your problems will increase manifold. Some accused close their bank account after issuing the check to other party or they issue the check from their closed bank account thinking that if they issue a check from their closed bank account, then it will not come within the purview of the check dishonor case. This is your galatfemi or a myth. If your check get bounced for whatever reason, whether you have stopped its payment or your account has been blocked by the banker or you have closed your bank account, then you are liable for the check dishonor under the Negotiable Instrument Act. It is possible that you have signed differently on the check than the signature available with the bank so that there is a signature mismatch. In that case, the court may send the check to the forensic lab and get it checked that whether it is your writing on the check or not. Please note that if your check is in the hands of other person, then the court will first ask you how your check reached in the hands of that other person. The presumption by the court is that the check has been given by you to other person against your legal and foreseeable loan or debt or liability, and you have already received the consideration against that check, and therefore you have issued this check or given the check to that other party. Because you will not give the check to somebody just for fun's sake, that is without any liability on you. This is the presumption under the Negotiable Instrument Act. Whatever it is, just I have discussed with you, they are not going to help you out in your check bounce case under the Negotiable Instrument Act before a court. My dear friends, it is my sincere advice to one and all that do not take the various defenses which I just shared with you in a check dishonor case against you, because they are not going to help you out but going to increase your problems in check dishonor case. Now, I will share with you various important points in check bounce case against you which you should use in the court, through which you can defend yourself in the court effectively and successfully. You should understand that the offense under Negotiable Instrument Act is a compoundable offense. Now you may ask, what is this compoundable offense? My dear friends, in certain offenses, the parties involved can enter into a compromise while the case is pending before the court. This is called compounding. Therefore, for your easy understanding, the meaning of compoundable offense is that there can be settlement between two parties to the dispute in check bounce case. If you are sure that you have really issued a check against your legal liability and you have given the check to a person against the money which was payable by you to that person, and that it was your legal liability, then you should try to settle the check bounce case by settlement with that person instead of fighting it in the court. The settlement can be done before the court case is filed by that party against you, or it can be done even after you have received the legal notice from that party, or settlement can be done after the case has been filed in the court by that party against you, or even during the pendency of the case also, you can do the settlement. You can request to the magistrate for settlement of the matter. In that case, your case can be referred to the mediation center. In the mediation center, some installments may also be made for the payment of the bounce check with the concurrence of both the parties. Therefore, my first advice to you is that if you are an accused in a check bounce case, then the easiest way out is that you should try to do the settlement with the party to whom you have issued the bounce check, so that you can save yourself from long-drawn litigation in the court and save your precious time and hard-earned money in litigation. This was the first mantra for you to save yourself in check bounce case through settlement. The next most important technical point or legal mantra is about the applicability of limitation period in check bounce case against you. Yes, the limitation period plays an important role while defending a check bounce case. Now, you will see how it is important as per Negotiable Instrument Act. The day on which check issued by you is bounced by the bank and the party to whom you issued the check got the intimation from his banker by way of written memo that check has got bounced, then the other party to whom you have issued that bounced check is legally bound that within 30 days from the date of receiving that written memo from his banker, he should send you a legal notice stating therein that check issued by you has bounced. He should also mention amount of the check in the legal notice sent to you. In that legal notice, he will give you 15 days time to repay the amount of the bounced check. That other party to whom you issued the bounced check is legally bound to give you this 15 days time for repayment of the amount of the bounced check. Once that 15 days period is passed or over, and still if you do not pay the amount of the bounced check to that party, then after passing of those 15 days time, the other party to whom you have issued the bounced check has got another 30 day time to file a suit against you in the court for recovery of the amount of the bounced check. Therefore, I have shared with you these three time limits which are very important in a check bounce case against you and should be strictly adhered to by the person to whom you have issued the bounce check. They are, first, 30 days period after getting the written memo from his banker about the dishonor of the check for sending the legal notice to you by that other party to whom you have issued the check which got dishonored. If he does not send the legal notice within 30 days after the receipt of written memo from his banker, then there will be a violation of the limitation period as per the Limitation Act by that person to whom you issued the bounced check, and you can get the check bounce case dismissed against you on this ground alone in the court. Hence, please note, this time limit of 30 days is very important, which should be looked into by you while defending your check bounce case. Or, if that person to whom you have issued the bounce check has filed the case in the court before the time period of 15 days for repayment given to you by him in the legal notice has completed or lapsed or passed, then it will be treated as a premature case, and on this ground also, the check bounce case can be dismissed by the court. Further, after completion or lapse of that 15 days time given to you for repayment, the other party has got another 30 days time to file the case in the court against you. If that person does not file case against you in the court within 30 days time after passing or completion or lapse of that 15 days notice period due to either his negligence or due to his ignorance or carelessness or due to any other reason whatsoever, then on this ground also his case can be dismissed by the court. Therefore, the second ground for dismissal of check bounce case against you by the court is on the basis of the limitation period. And if you find on the facts of your case that there is a violation of the limitation period by the person to whom you issued the bounce check, then you should brought this fact of limitation period to the notice of the magistrate that this case is barred by limitation, and then the entire case against you can be dismissed by the court on the point of limitation alone. This is the second important legal point to be kept in mind while defending your case of check dishonor in the court, which will help you to get your check dishonor case dismissed by the court. Now, I will share with you the another legal and important point for dismissal of check bounce case against you by the court. This is again very important point in a check bounce case, and that is legal liability, which you should use in the court, through which you can defend yourself in the court effectively and successfully and get the check dishonor case dismissed against you. This I am going to share with you in detail so that you can understand this properly and apply to your check bounce case in defense. If your case of check bounce case falls in any of the category which I am just going to share with you, then you can defend your case effectively and the case can be dismissed by the court and you may be acquitted from check dishonor case by the court. This point is all about the legal liability. The legal liability plays a very crucial role while defending a check bounce case. Now you will ask that what is this legal liability all about? My dear friends, please check your legal liability as per section 138 of the Negotiable Instrument Act when a check issued by you got bounced. Please note that every check bounce is not an offense in itself as per section 138 of the Negotiable Instrument Act. Only those checks which were issued by you against the discharge of your legal liability, and if those checks got bounced, then only it is an offense as per the Negotiable Instrument Act, and not that every check bounce is an offense. You may be thinking that it's amazing and you never saw your check bounce case from that angle. My dear friends, if you have issued a check against your liability, and that is your legal liability, and you have issued the check in discharge of your existing legal liability and that got bounced, then only it is an offense under the Negotiable Instrument Act and not otherwise. Meaning thereby that if you were legally liable to pay that amount to other person against your legal liability and not otherwise. If you have issued a check to repay your debt or liability, whether that is loan or liability or any other liability under a contract, and you have issued the check in discharge of that liability to other person and that check got bounced, whether you are paying your debt or liability partially by check or in full and that check has got bounced, then that is an offense under the Negotiable Instrument Act. My dear friend, this is very technical and important point as far as defending your check dishonor case is concerned, and therefore you should understand this very carefully so that you may get the check dishonor case against you dismissed by the court on the point of legal liability itself. Now take an example wherein you have issued a check to somebody, then as per section 139 of the Negotiable Instrument Act, it is presumed under law that you have given that check to that other party in discharge of your either loan or some other legal liability and not for just fun's sake. Therefore, you have given that check in discharge of your some legal liability to that other party. This is presumed under section 139 of the Negotiable Instrument Act. It shall not be accepted by the court that you have given that check to some party or some person just for fun's sake when you were not having any legal liability or a loan on you to repay to him. Therefore, please note that the law will not accept your justification that you have given the check to that person when there was no legal liability against you. Likewise, Section 118 of the Negotiable Instrument Act presumes that whatever consideration was due against the check issued by you has already been received by you. And therefore, the check has been issued by you against already received consideration by you. The consideration means, if you purchase a car from a car dealer, then you have issued the check to that car dealer for which you have already received the car from him. That you have already received means you have already got the car from that car dealer. Hence, it will be presumed that you have already received the car from that car dealer, then only you have issued that check to that car dealer. You will not issue a check in free fund to anybody, but it is issued by you against which you have already received the consideration. You have already received the consideration which you were legally entitled to receive from that person against the check issued by you. Now see, these presumptions which I have just discussed with you have to be rebutted by you to get the check bounce case dismissed in the court. These presumptions of law which I shared with you just now, you have to prove that they are not true or rebut with documentary evidence or by explaining the circumstances before the court. During the course of the trial, before the court, whatever evidence or witnesses you produce before the court or whatever circumstances you explain, that should prove under what circumstances you issued the check in question to that other party or how your signed check reached in the hands of that other party. Once you throw the light on these facts or circumstances before the court by way of your statement or bayan or by way of your witnesses or by way of your documentary evidence, then you should be able to prove before the court that whatever check you issued to the complainant, that check was not issued in discharge of your legal liability and you were not liable to pay him any amount. This should be your mission or effort to prove before the court. If you can prove this fact before the court, or if you can prove to a greater extent, even if you are not able to prove this fully, then you may be able to create a doubt in the mind of the court that whatever you are explaining before the court, those things are also possible. If you are able to prove, if not 100%, but to a greater extent before the court, that whatever you are telling or explaining before the court, that is also a possible view. In that case, various evidences produced by the complainant or the other party can also be seen with suspicion, and they are also not free from doubt, then you can win the case. Now you should understand that what I have just discussed with you, with the help of few examples, that what can be the difference between issuing a check by you to the other person or party or issuing a check against your legal liability to the other person or party. Now I will share with you this difference in detail. Now I will share with you this with the help of an example. For example, if a father gives a gift to his son of rupees 20 lakh by way of check and that check gets bounced, now tell me whether the son can file a case against his father for recovery of that gift amount because the check gets bounced. If your answer is yes, then my dear friends, you are not correct. In this case, son cannot file a case against his father for dishonor of this check because there was no legal liability of father towards his son to give a gift to him. The father was gifting this amount to his son as per his own sweet will out of his love and affection towards his son. But he was legally not liable to give that amount as gift to his son. This is just an example. Even if you are giving any gift to any person and that check gets bounced, then that person cannot file a suit against you for recovery of the gift amount. Or if you are giving a donation to somebody and that check of donation get bounced, then the person to whom you have given the donation cannot file a case against you for recovery of the donation amount if that check get bounced. If you are giving any donation to any temple like Ram Janmabhoomi or the Birla temple or Shirdi temple or to any Gurudwara like Golden temple or Gurudwara Shish Ganj or to anybody for that matter through check, then if that check got dishonored, then you are not liable to pay that amount and that person cannot file a suit against you in the court for recovery of that amount because you are legally not liable to pay that amount to them. Even if you stop the payment of a check and that check got bounced, then that person or institution to whom you have given that donation cannot file a case against you in the court for recovery of that amount due to dishonor of the check because there is no legal liability on you to pay that donation to that person or organization. Even if that person institute a case or files a case against you for recovery of that amount due to dishonor of check, then you can take a ground before the court that this amount was not your legal liability and you are not liable to pay this amount legally to that person. Hence, check bounce case shall be dismissed against you by the court because you have not purchased any goods from him or them, or you have not taken any services from them, and you have not taken any loan also from that person, and therefore this was not your legal liability to pay that amount to them. You have not given this amount as repayment of loan also, but you have given this amount to him or them as a donation or a gift, and later on you change your mind that you do not wish to give that donation or gift, and therefore this was not your legal liability. In this case, the court cannot force you to pay that amount because this was not your legal liability. Negotiable Instrument Act clearly prescribes that a check given for discharge of legal liability is only an offense under that act and not otherwise. If any other check given by you get bounced, then that is not an offense under Negotiable Instrument Act. Now, for example, X, the complainant, has filed a case against Y, the accused, for dishonor of check in the court. X has complained that he has given a cash loan of rupees 15 lakh to Y, and he, that is Y, gave him that check for return of that cash loan, which has bounced or dishonored, and therefore he filed a case against him, Y, for dishonor of check. Now, just presume that you, that is Y, is the accused for this dishonor of check, and then what probable defense are available with you? This may be that by way of documentary evidence, you can prove the financial capacity of X during the course of trial before the court that X never had so much money in his bank account. Or you may request the court that X should be ordered to produce his income tax return for last 5 years before the court, which will prove that what X is stating is highly improbable, that he has given a loan of rupees 15 lakh to Y because he never had so much money in his bank account and he was filing his income tax return of rupees 1 lakh only every year, then how he can give a loan of rupees 15 lakh to Y? Further, on checking the bank statement of X, if no withdrawal of rupees 15 lakh is made by him, then you can doubt this fact to the knowledge of the court that it is clear that he never withdrew rupees 15 lakh from his bank account. Also, X, who is claiming that he has given a loan of rupees 15 lakh to Y, then it should be seen that what is his profession or business or occupation. If he is either unemployed or he is running a small tuition center or he is a mechanic or he is having a small general merchant shop, then a person having this type of a small profession or business or occupation who cannot earn even rupees 15 lakh, what to talk about of saving rupees 15 lakh, then how he can give loan of rupees 15 lakh to buy? This fact should be brought to the knowledge of the court. If a doubt is created in the mind of the court that X never had rupees 15 lakh at any point of time, and also his financial position is not so that he can advance rupees 15 lakh to anybody, and he is not earning and saving that much of the money, and there is no concrete evidence, that is documentary evidence in the possession of X, which can prove that X would have given rupees 15 lakh to Y as loan, then the probability of winning the case will tilt in your favor, and you can win this case on this ground alone, stating that whatever check you gave to X, that was not for discharge of your legal liability, and that you never took the loan of rupees 15 lakh from X. Now let us presume that what could be the reverse scenario in this case. The reverse could be that X has taken the loan from you. For example, X filed a case against you. However, the fact was that you advanced money to X in the form of a loan for which you issued a check to X. Later on, after issuing the check to X, you change your mind because you got the information from your reliable sources that X is not an honest person and he has not returned the money taken on loan from the market from other persons in the past, and therefore you decided that you will not give loan to X. Due to the reason of not giving the loan to X by you, dishonesty came into the mind of X and he got that check dishonored which was given by you to X as loan. Then after X made a bogus case against you that X had given loan in cash to you and you were returning that loan by way of this check which you issued, and X got that check dishonored. In this transaction, there was no legal liability on you towards X. I hope now you could understand this case properly and apply to the facts of your case and win the check bouncing case. Negotiable Instrument Act clearly prescribes that if a check is given for discharge of legal liability, then only it is an offense under this act and not otherwise. If you have given a check for any other purpose to a person and that is not for discharge of your legal liability which got bounced, then that is not an offense under Negotiable Instrument Act. Now I will share with you another example to bring more clarity on this issue. There is a firm that is Total Dishonest Limited, and Mr. Honest gave a check to that firm which got bounced. Now, Total Dishonest Limited filed a case for recovery of the amount of bounced check in the court against Mr. Honest, stating before the court that Total Dishonest Limited had given a loan to Mr. Honest and Mr. Honest gave that check in repayment of that loan which got bounced. Now presume that you are Mr. Honest in this case. Now you can request the court that the firm Total Dishonest Limited should be ordered to produce its balance sheet, profit and loss account and financials before the court. Since Total Dishonest Limited is a legal entity and if it gives a loan to anybody, then it should naturally be shown in its books of accounts and financials, meaning thereby that this loan will be shown in its financials as a loan given to you as recoverable amount. If there is no outstanding amount appearing in against you in its financials or in its balance sheet, then there will be a doubt created in the mind of the court that how Total Dishonest Limited can give a loan which has not been shown in its financials or the loan in advances. If doubt is created in the mind of the court, then it will be in your favor, that is accused against whom the complaint has been filed by Total Dishonest Limited. Now I will share with you another example which will bring more clarity in this regard. Say for example, you have given a check to a person or a trader for the purchase of certain goods. When you went to the shop or showroom of that trader, then he showed you the sample of the goods which you approved, that okay, this particular quality of product you will be purchasing, say for example Sony TV. You were satisfied with that sample and then you issued a check for purchase of those Sony TV. But once you received in actual those goods, then you found that those goods were completely different. Their quality was inferior and they were not conforming to the sample which you approved for purchase from that person, or the product supplied by that person to you is completely of the different model than what you approved for purchase at the time of order, or the brand was entirely different, say it was LG and not Sony. Hence, whatever terms you have agreed for the purchase of product at the time of placing the order were not fully complied with and adhere to by the supplier, maybe its quality, maybe its brand, or some other parameters. Once you receive the goods supplied by the supplier in actual, then you find it entirely different. Then you instruct your banker to stop payment of the check. Once you stop payment of the check, then the check get bounced. Once check get bounced, then the supplier files a suit against you in the court for check bounce and for recovery of that amount. In this case, because the contract was done by the supplier by misrepresentation, by false promise, therefore, you should return the goods to the supplier and you can cancel your order and there will be no legal liability upon you for this check bounce. There will be no legal liability upon you to pay the amount to that supplier for this bounce check, because he has sold the goods to you by fraud, forgery, misrepresentation, false representation, and that he has obtained the check by fraud, forgery, misrepresentation, or false representation. In this case, you will be acquitted and there will be no liability upon you for check bounce. Now I will discuss another example. This will look you rather more interesting. Now, as I told you that there should be a legal liability, my dear friends, there should not only be a legal liability, but it should be existing one also. Yes, it should be existing one. Now you will ask that what is this existing liability? This is also very important and very crucial for a case to be defended by you. There should not be any future legal liability upon you. For example, you have taken a loan of rupees 10 lakh, that is car loan, from your bank for 5 years and you are paying EMI, that is equated monthly installment of rupees 20,000 every month to your bank. After paying installment for 5 months, 6 installment got bounced due to non-payment by you. Then your bank files a case for recovery of that bounced ECS under section 138 of the Negotiable Instrument Act against you for recovery of that amount. You may recall that your bank had already taken post-dated blank signed check from you, that is PDC, at the time of the disbursement of loan. Now, what your banker does, he fills the entire outstanding amount of rupees 9 lakh plus up to date outstanding interest plus penalty in the blank check after payment of 5 EMIs by you, say for rupees 10.5 lakh in the PDC given by you to your banker and present it to your bank for payment. Naturally, the check get bounced due to insufficiency of fund. Please note that your lender has not recalled this loan and has not issued any loan recall letter to you for this loan, stating therein that your EMI has bounced and therefore it is recalling the entire loan today from you before presenting this PDC to your banker for payment. Hence, though your banker has got this check of rupees 10.5 lakh that is for principal, interest and penalty bounced, but this entire amount was not your existing liability. No doubt that you are liable to pay rupees 10.5 lakh to the bank as on date, but whether this entire amount of rupees 10.5 lakh was your existing liability or not is to be looked into and checked from the facts of your case. My dear friends, this total amount of 10.5 lakh was not your existing liability on the date when the check got bounced. On that date, only existing liability, that is 1 EMI of rupees 20,000 was payable by you and not the entire amount of rupees 10.5 lakh because you have taken the loan for 5 years from the bank and the remaining amount except 1 EMI was your future liability. This is the finer and minute difference between a future liability and existing legal liability. Only 1 month EMI was your existing liability and not the entire amount of rupees 10.5 lakh. Please note that you have taken the loan for 5 years of rupees 10 lakh and that is to be repaid in 60 monthly installments and not within 1 year, and you will be repaying rupees 20,000 each month in the form of EMI. Therefore, when after 5 months, when the bank presented the check for rupees 10.5 lakh and got the check bounced and did not recall that loan before that, then your existing liability was not rupees 10.5 lakh. That was a future liability and your existing liability was rupees 20,000 only. Hence, in this case, since rupees 10.5 lakh was not your existing liability but a future legal liability and your existing liability was only rupees 20,000. So in this case, when there was no existing liability but future liability and check was presented for future liability, then these facts will also go in your favor because there was no existing legal liability upon you. Now I will share with you another example for your easy understanding. Say for example, you want to purchase stolen goods or smuggled goods, that is chori ka maal from somebody, and you have issued check for the purchase of those stolen goods or smuggled goods, or you have purchased certain goods from a person which are prohibited by law or is illegal, or you want to purchase certain goods which are banned under the Narcotics and Drug Protection Act, and you issued a check for those purchases and check got bounced and that person made a court case against you for the recovery of that amount for bounced check. Now question will be coming to your mind that whether check which you have given to that person shall be treated as your legal liability or not. Answer is big no, not at all. It shall not be treated your legal liability because the contact between you and that person was for an unlawful and illegal activity and therefore this contract shall not be recognized as a valid contract in the eye of law as per Contract Act. Purchase of stolen goods is unlawful. Also, purchase of banned narcotic drugs is illegal. Hence, if the contract itself is unlawful and is not legal and is invalid, then whatever consideration you have paid for that unlawful activity or illegal contract, how that can become lawful or legal? Therefore, in this case also, there is no legal and enforceable liability upon you, and you will be acquitted in this case. Let me discuss with you another example also. Say for instance, you are running a company and you are a director of that private limited company. Your company issued a check to somebody and that check got bounced. Or your company gave a check to some of its dealer or supplier or customer or to somebody for that matter, which gets bounced, and that person files a suit against you for recovery of that amount for the bounced check. Here that person to whom check was issued by the company has filed a suit against you in your personal capacity as well as against the company. Please note that as per section 141 of the Negotiable Instrument Act, if a check issued by the company is bounced, then the company will be liable and every person who was controlling and running the business of that company or who was in charge of the business of that company and the business was run under his guidance and supervision shall also be treated as an accused and shall be liable for the check dishonor. That person can be any person and designation of that person does not matter, whatever may be his designation in that company. This is called vicarious liability. The meaning of vicarious liability is to become liable for somebody else's act. Here, if you are working in a company, whether you are an accountant or a director or a manager, whether you are a director or a general manager, and a check of your company bounced, and the party to whom this check is issued has filed a case against the company and has made you also an accused in your personal capacity. Now, to get acquitted from this case, you have to prove before the court and you should be able to explain such circumstances with documentary evidence or otherwise that at the time when the offense happened, that is, when the check got bounced, then at that time, you were not in charge of the business of that company and you were not conducting the business of that company. The business of the company was not conducted under your supervision. You were not in charge of that business and it was not within your knowledge that this check had been issued to the other party. Further, this was also not in your knowledge that if the check would have been issued, then it will get bounced. Hence, if you are able to satisfy the court about the various facts with documentary evidence, which I discussed with you just now, then also you will be acquitted. However, the company remains an accused and the other employees or officers of the company who were actually in charge for conducting the business of the company will also be liable, but you will be acquitted if you are able to prove before the court with the documentary evidence that you were not in charge of the business when the bounce check was issued. So, you will be acquitted if you are able to prove before the court that you did not know about this and you were not having any responsibility as in charge in that company, nor there are your signature on the check. Also, you were not authorized signatory of the company when the bounce check was issued, and neither you knew that how much is the balance in the bank account of the company, and you are not at all related in any manner whatsoever to this check bouncing, even if you were the employee of that company, then you will win this case in your personal capacity and you will be acquitted from this case. Now take another example. You should check in the facts of your case that whether the check which got dishonored was presented within the validity period of 3 months from the date of its issue by the other party or not. If the check was presented by the party after 3 months period from the date of its issue and check got dishonored due to this reason, then you will be acquitted from the check dishonor case. Further, you should note that if you are acquitted from the check bounce case under the Negotiable Instrument Act, then it does not mean that the other party cannot file a civil recovery suit against you. Say, for example, on any technical ground, that is, maybe on limitation period, you get the case dismissed under Section 138 of the Negotiable Instrument Act, still you are liable to pay the amount, or if the bank has presented the check by filling increased amount and the case of bank got dismissed on that ground, even then you were not liable for that increased amount of the check. However, you were liable to pay that reduced actual amount and bank will file the civil recovery suit against you. So, the civil recovery suit is a civil suit which will run parallelly and separately against you for the recovery of that amount. Likewise, though the police does not file FIR in the cases under Section 138 of the Negotiable Instrument Act, but if the facts of the case show to the police that you have done forgery with other person, or you have done cheating, or aapne kisi ka maal bhadap liya hai, or after issuing the check, you have absconded, or your malafide intention is apparent from the facts of the case, that you have done all these things with the intention to defraud the other person, then the FIR may be filed against you under the relevant sections of the Indian Penal Code, that is under Section 420, as per the facts of the case. My dear friends, though dishonor of check is in itself not an offense as per Section 138 of the Negotiable Instrument Act, and it is an offense if there is a legal liability. Once you are proved guilty by the court, then you can be punished with imprisonment up to 2 years and you may be liable to pay the double of the amount of the check bounce as fine may be imposed upon you also or both. Hope this video would help you out in getting acquittal from the court in check bounce case and win the same. Stay safe and healthy. Bye-bye.